Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to Trinity Lutheran Church. I'm Pastor Tim Fraker. It's my joy to welcome you as we come together on this special day on Palm Sunday. Lots of fun stuff for today, and I'll let you know kind of what to expect that's a little different this morning in just a minute. But if you're a guest with us this morning, I'd like to extend a special word of welcome. I'm glad that you're here as a part of our church family. I'll invite you to fill out a Connect card. We'd love to know that you're here. That's in the back of the pew in front of you. And also our members, we'd love to know you're here too. Please fill it out. On the back side of that is a place for prayer requests. If you have anything in particular you'd like us to pray for, what to do with that would be to put into the offering plate if you have a prayer request. Then our ushers will grab those, hand them to me, and we'll be able to pray for them this morning. Otherwise, just pass them to the center aisle, and after the offering, when our ushers head back up the aisle, then they will take those from you. So for Palm Sunday, we will have a procession for our first hymn. So in a moment, I'll invite you to stand and face the cross while we sing our first hymn, and also invite you to wave your palm branches as we sing as well. That'll be lots of fun. Yes, I think that's mostly the different thing for this morning. As we come together and have been coming together in the season of Lent, and also as we come together here in the beginning of Holy Week, we are coming together under this theme of being guided to the cross and wondering what we will see there. Today, we see Jesus' humility, especially in this day on Palm Sunday, but all throughout his life and ministry that led to the cross, the humility of Jesus that won our salvation. This is what centers our hearts and minds this morning as God comes to us through his word. All right, with that, I'll invite you to stand, face the cross as we sing the processional hymn.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? Lift up your heads, O gates, and lift them up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory?
The Lord of hosts, he is the King of glory.
Behold, your King is coming to you. Righteous and having salvation is he, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. Let us then confess our sins to God and ask his forgiveness. Almighty God, we are called to humble ourselves and to serve one another in love. But instead, we become puffed up with pride. We look on others as less important than ourselves. We do not humble ourselves before your word, and we do not walk in the way of love. Have mercy on us and forgive us. God has had mercy on us. He sent his Son to be our Savior. Jesus humbled himself, and on the cross he suffered in our place, the penalty of death that we deserved for our sins. For his sake, God forgives us. I announce to you that your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord.
Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in.
Who is this King of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty, the Lord, mighty in battle. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you are the King of glory, yet you enter Jerusalem in humble majesty to bring us salvation. During this holy week, as we follow your final path to the cross, lead us in humility and meekness. Help us to put the needs of others ahead of our own and to walk in love, forgiving one another as we have been forgiven. Jesus, humble King, we hail you as our Lord and Savior. You are the King of glory. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
The Old Testament reading is from Zechariah chapter 9. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. Righteous and having salvation is he. Humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the war horse from Jerusalem. And the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall speak peace to the nations. His rule shall be from sea to sea, and from the river to the ends of the earth. As for you also, because of the blood of my covenant with you. I will set your prisoners free from the waterless pit. Return to your stronghold, O prisoners of hope. Today I declare that I will restore to you double. This is the word of the Lord.
The epistle this morning is from James, the fourth chapter. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be wretched and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will exalt you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. I invite the congregation to stand as we honor the person and work of Jesus Christ. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 11th chapter. When they drew near to Jerusalem, to Bethphage and Bethany, at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village in front of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find a colt tied on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' say, 'The Lord has need of it, and will send it back here immediately.' And they went away and found a colt tied at a door outside in the street, and they untied it. And some of those standing there said to them, 'What are you doing untying the colt?' And they told them what Jesus had said, and they let them go. And they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. And many spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut from the fields. And those who went before and those who followed were shouting, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest!' This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ."
Congregation may be seated. At this time, I invite forward the children for the children's message. Good morning. Come on up. Come on up. Have a seat and face me. Good morning. Have a seat on the ground and face me. Awesome. Good morning. How are y'all today? Good. Good. So today is a special day, isn't it? We did something a little bit different at the beginning of the church service. What did we do? Yeah. So there was a parade, right? We just read about, did you hear that Jesus kind of was in a parade? Yeah, so it's Palm Sunday. So it was a big celebration that there were people waving palms, kind of a parade. Yeah, and we're actually going to talk about parades in the next sermon too, so good thinking. It's Palm Sunday, and this marks the beginning of a special week. We call it Holy Week, yeah, because this is the last week of Jesus' life. There's a lot of big kind of days that come up. We'll have church services on Thursday when Jesus instituted the Lord's Supper, when he was betrayed, and then Good Friday we'll have church services. That was when Jesus died. Yeah, but there's good stuff that came out of it, right? Because I know. And then what happens next Sunday? Do you know what special day that is? It's Easter, right? And that's when we celebrate. Yeah. And that's when we celebrate Jesus rising from the dead. So this is a pretty big week for church and for Jesus' life, right? So today, as we had the parade, there was a special word that they used, and it said two or three times, Hosanna. Yeah, this word means save us now, or like Lord save us. It's kind of a prayer, it's kind of a plea, and it maybe sounds a little bit weird in a parade, right? When we think of parades, we're happy and lots of good stuff going on.
And he wants to do a parade.
Yeah, and that's a lot of fun. But the words Hosanna are a little bit different. And you know, but that's a really appropriate, that's a really good word for this week and for today. Because it's Jesus. And he's the one that we ask to save us. He's the one who went to the cross to save us. He's the one who loves us so much that he would die to save us. So even though it might be a little weird in a parade, it was the perfect word for who Jesus was and what he is up to this week. So that helps us remember today that as we come together as God's people, we look to Jesus to save us. All right? All right, so let's close by folding our hands, closing our eyes, repeating after me. Dear Jesus, thank you for all you have done for us on this special week. Lord, save us. And thank you for saving us. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thanks for coming up. Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. As we come together on this Palm Sunday, we see, both as we kind of live that out again in the procession and here in our gospel lesson, we see a parade of sorts. Now, there was a pretty big parade a few months back. Back in, I think, early November, parade to celebrate our baseball team, right? Anybody go to the Rangers victory parade? No? Okay. At least what I researched said that there was between an estimated 500 to 700,000 people. That many fans go to celebrate this victory parade. What a massive, especially because if you think of like how many, what the population is, that's a huge percentage of the population to go and celebrate victory, right? The World Series, the best baseball team, certainly in our country, arguably the world, all that good stuff, right? What a fascinating parade. What a wonderful thing. Now, I don't know what comes in your mind when you hear parade or think of parade, but what comes to my mind is either like the 4th of July parades or fair parades growing up, right? So you're sitting on the side of a street and you see fire trucks go by, maybe classic cars, maybe politicians or influential people, or you know, the little cars that spin and all these things. People are throwing candy. You know, it's just a lot of fun, right? Especially if you have something to block the sun, because typically it's just really hot, right? And everybody gets sunburned, and I guess that's part of the fun. I don't know. In biblical times, there were also parades, a little bit different, right? Typically, this would have been maybe ones that showed military might, whether that's in Jesus' times and the Romans coming with strong war horses and the armies, the soldiers in their gleaming armor, or whether it was a king or the men returning back from battle victorious. There were parades to celebrate victory. And so oftentimes, it's very easy when we think of Palm Sunday, when we live out this procession and when we connect to Jesus' triumphal entry is what we call it. These are the pictures that come into our mind. But Jesus' parade today, Jesus' triumphal entry, is really a different kind of parade. It's a parade about humility. Now, humility is kind of a funny thing. Because on the one hand, if someone is humbled, right, if you were to say, I was humbled by this, usually that has a negative connotation, right? Like that's not usually a positive thing, a good thing, to be humbled. Some of that because it's opposite and all those things. But if we were to say that somebody is humble or that somebody has humility, we usually think of that as a positive characteristic. So humility can be a funny thing. And as we gather as God's people today, as we are guided to the cross, today we see on display Jesus' humility. Today we are guided to humility. Humility that we certainly see on this day of Palm Sunday, but humility then that we notice all throughout Jesus' life and ministry. Jesus began with humility. Even before he was born, the idea, the fact that God was going to become part of his creation, that God would be born, is an act, a decision, movement of humility. A humbling of God to become created. But Jesus' birth was a humble birth. We talk about this every year, probably. We know the story of Christmas, and so these things are not really a surprise to us, right? Jesus was born in a small town of Bethlehem, a little town of Bethlehem, not in the big, bustling city of Jerusalem, not where the seats of power were. Jesus was born to parents who were probably very likely poor, not wealthy, not influential, not well-known, ordinary, average, humble. Even when he was born, right, we know this story, the Mary and Joseph went to Bethlehem because of the census and all these things. Even that kind of context of how he was born is a very humble birth because his parents didn't even have a place to stay in town. Jesus' birth in itself and all that surrounds it speaks to his humble life. And his growing up is very similar too. There's very little we know from Jesus of like age 2-ish to when his ministry started around 30, right? And that again speaks to Jesus' humility. He was raised, he grew up in a small town. Something that, you know, we really, it seems like he was very unnoticed. He lived a very normal life, a very humble life. There's really nothing, very little that we know about it. And so we see in Jesus, even in his growing up years, it highlights the humble life that Jesus lived. His ministry was also marked with humility. Because, yes, Jesus did have quite the following. But as we read the Gospels, as we hear about his ministry, about how he lived, how he taught, even the miracles he did, we notice that it wasn't about getting notoriety. His ministry wasn't about getting enough subscribers, right, to get the right likes, to generate enough revenue on his social media platforms and other streams of income, right? That wasn't what Jesus did. That wasn't what his ministry was about. It wasn't to get in the right circles and to get on the right side of the right influential people so that he could raise in authority and power and have a cushy life. That's not what Jesus' ministry was like. In fact, it was often the opposite, as the religious leaders were often butting heads with him. As he would often, even when crowds would come, and he would often then go off to another place to preach and to teach and to do miracles. In his ministry, Jesus was humble in his actions. It wasn't about gaining things for himself. Then that leads us to today, to Palm Sunday, this triumphal entry, this parade that really is also marked with humility. I mean, I can kind of picture myself on kind of a big hill, seeing Jesus come down. And as we see this scene, we see Jesus riding on a donkey. And right then, we see a picture of humility because, like we noticed before, Jesus isn't riding on a war horse of victory, right? He's not riding like maybe the Romans would. He's not riding like the kings of the Old Testament and their victory parades would. He's riding on a donkey. And yes, actually, there is significance in this from the Old Testament, right? That's our Old Testament lesson from Zechariah 9, that there is some connection to prophecy and the Messiah and all this stuff. And that's good and appropriate and fulfilled in Jesus. And the point of that was actually humility. The point of the king riding in on a donkey was to point to him not being the true king of God's people. Point is that the one who should ride the horse is God himself. is the Father. The true King of God's people is God himself. And so as we look at this scene and see Jesus on a donkey, we notice, you and I notice, we know who Jesus is. We know he actually is God himself. And so we see like, oh, he actually should be on a horse, but he's not. It highlights Jesus' humility. And as we're at this scene, we behold Jesus on a donkey, and we hear some words, Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna. Words that are filled with humility. Lord, save us. Save us now. They're a cry, a plea, a prayer of people in need of help. People who are humbled, who are oppressed. Both the people under the Roman government and both you and I in life. People needing saved. Words that fill the air with humility. Then as we behold this scene, see Jesus on this donkey, hear the words of Hosanna, we see other things waving, palm branches, right? These also remind us, point us toward humility in a couple of ways. These are, yes, fun, leafy greens. There are lots of different types of palms, right? Who knows what it looked like? But what will these palms look like in about a week? They'll be, these particular ones, I think, turn kind of yellow. So they'll be kind of brown. They'll be crunchy, right? Any kind of fresh green, fresh flowers, that kind of stuff. Like, after a little while, especially if you don't put them in water, like, they get a little rough, right? So even the celebration reminds us that this is, has a short lifespan to it. The palms themselves. And it's fascinating, I don't know if you know this, but traditionally, the ashes that we use on Ash Wednesday are taken from palms from the previous year that are dried and burned. And so there's a further connection as we talk about these palm branches and see the decay that'll happen, the short time lifespan of these palm branches that remind us of humility, but we're reminded even more as we look forward to Ash Wednesday where we receive the sign of the cross and remember that we are dust and to dust we shall return. So the palms in a number of ways remind us of the humility present for us in this scene. Humility fills this scene and humility is what marks this road that Jesus is riding on. Because this road leads to the cross. This road leads to his death. A road of humility. And Jesus' death is a very humble death. Listen to how Paul describes this. And he's encouraging Christians to be humble like Jesus is, and he points to his death, points to the cross. Listen to this from Philippians chapter 2. Paul says, "Do nothing from rivalry or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others, having this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking on the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross." Jesus' road of humility led him to the cross, led him to death and even death on a cross. A crucifixion, not just being a humble death, but a death that's cursed. A cursed is anyone who hangs on a tree. So throughout Jesus' life, throughout his ministry, and especially this week, today, Palm Sunday, leading forward to his death, we see that Jesus' life is marked with humility. This is how Jesus lived. And the result of all that humility, the result of Jesus' work, the result of Jesus' presence, his life, and his ministry, is your salvation. That's what this was all about. That's why Jesus humbled himself, was to die and to rise again. The point of Jesus' humility was his suffering and death. And the result of that is our salvation. And actually, a reversal for Jesus himself. Because Jesus was not only humbled, but then raised up. He was exalted, literally, from death to life. He was raised from the dead on Easter Sunday. Well, I mean, spoiler alert, we'll talk about that next week, right? Right? He was raised up from the dead. He was raised up then, again, 40 days later in the ascension, raised up to heaven to be with the Father. And the New Testament talks about how his name is raised above all names. Because in Jesus, through his humility, we have life and salvation. So Jesus' humility leads to his raising up, his exaltation, his salvation that he has won for you and me. And so as we come together in the season of Lent, as we're guided to the cross and we see Jesus' humility, it begins to work in us. And first, our first response is gratitude. Is being thankful to Jesus for his humility and for his work to save us. That God himself would humble himself for us. So we are grateful. And we say thank you. That means that fills our prayers often. Thank you, Lord, for saving us. It also means part of our gratitude, not just saying that, not just praying that, part of our gratitude is actually receiving this grace often. It means coming together as God's people to worship, to receive God's gifts through his word and sacraments, to come together as a people, receive anew his love, and be filled. That's part of being grateful for God's gifts, is to receive them often. And also part of our gratitude is to give back some of the blessings that God has given to us, and in response to the blessings that God has given us. That's really why the offering is a part of our worship service. I mean, sure, we have to pay the bills and all that kind of stuff, right? But that's not the main point. The point is, it's an act of gratitude in response to God's blessings to us. First and foremost, our salvation, won by Jesus' humility. But also the many other blessings that God gives to us in this life. And so part of our gratitude is then giving back to the Lord, financially and otherwise, out of thanks for his gifts to us. So we respond to Jesus' humility with our gratitude. And we also respond in living humbly for him. That's what Paul reminds us, encourages us in Philippians 2. Did you catch that? Verse 5, have this mind among yourselves, that humble mind, right? Which is yours in Christ Jesus. This is who we are now in Jesus because of what he has done and won for us. This is who we are. And so that means that we live humbly for him. It means that we live in community with other people, that we serve and care and even sacrifice for other people around us. It means that we value our spiritual lives, that we value our relationship with God. It means that we live lives in accordance, in following Jesus' parable and example of the Good Samaritan, right? Who went out of his way to help somebody in need. We live humbly for Jesus, knowing that in the kingdom of God, greatness is humility, and humility is greatness. This Lent, we are being guided to the cross. And today, as we come together, see this parade, see Jesus' cross, we see Jesus' humility. We are grateful for it, for all that Jesus has won and given to us. And so, as God's people, we live humbly for him. In Jesus' name, amen. And now may the peace of God, which surpasses all of our understanding, keep our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. I invite the congregation to stand as we confess our faith together. We do this using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Congregation may be seated as we receive the offering. Once again, good morning. Great to be with you. Thank you for your partnership as we come together as God's people and work together to share the humility of Jesus and the blessings we receive from that. What I wanted to highlight today is something that is coming up this week, and that is each day Beth and I will give daily devotionals. So it'll be a video, a short video, maybe 2 or 3 minutes, something like that, each of these days, to help connect us, to help keep us centered on this week, what Jesus is up to for us. So there'll be a number of different ways that you can find that. It'll be on Facebook, it'll be on Instagram, it'll be on our YouTube, and that YouTube link will be in our emails. So if you're on any of those and would like to follow along with those devotionals, that's where you'll find them. They will be posted each day, and would invite you to come together and receive those as God continues to work in us this week. Thanks. Please stand as we sing together.
Thank you.
we go to the Lord in prayer this morning, we remember those on our prayer list. We also have a couple of extra requests. We pray for Austin, the nephew of Randy and Cindy Kelly, who has a mass behind his heart. We pray for Aaron, a friend of Newlands and Kunyavsky's, who's having brain surgery this week to remove a tumor. We also pray for Brad, a friend of Don Goetz, who has prostate cancer. And we also pray for Hannah, a friend of Stephanie Santibanez, who has an appointment testing for cancer tomorrow. We go to the Lord in prayer. Jesus, King of Glory, you entered Jerusalem in humility and meekness. You did not come to fight armies and set up an earthly kingdom. You came to bring salvation, to suffer and die on the cross as the atoning sacrifice for the sins of the world. Jesus, humble King,
save us.
Jesus, King of Glory, during this holy week, we will follow you as you take up your path to the cross. We will receive the gift of your body and blood in your Holy Supper. We will follow you to Gethsemane and watch with you through your betrayal, arrest, and condemnation. We will see with eyes of faith your humble death and victorious resurrection. Jesus, humble King,
save us for us, humility.
Jesus, King of Glory, lead us to walk in your steps in humility and love. Teach us to put others first, as you put our needs ahead of your own. We want to follow you, our King, and to pattern our lives after your life. Jesus, humble King,
save your cross for us, humility.
Jesus, King of Glory, look with mercy on those who are suffering in pain, illness, or grief, especially those on our prayer list and those on our hearts and minds. Lord, lead us to help and serve them in love and to bring them the hope and comfort found in your word. Jesus, humble King,
save your cross.
Jesus, King of Glory, you humbled yourself, obedient to your heavenly Father, even to the point of death on a cross. On the third day after your death, you were raised in exalted glory, as we by faith one day will be raised to live in your presence forever. Jesus, humble King,
save your cross for us, humility.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your King is coming to you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Please be seated for the closing hymn.
Thank you.
Once again, good morning. Great to have all of you here with us. A couple announcements before we head out. First of all, special thanks to Rowan Aguilar, who provided some percussion in some of our music. So thank you, Rowan. Also, we'll direct your attention to some of the announcements. There are a couple that are new that I'll tell you in just a second. This is Holy Week. You've already heard that a couple of times. We have services both on Thursday and Friday. Both days have services at 2 and 7, and they are the same services at each of those times. There is communion on Thursday, not on Friday, and then Easter Sunday is at 8 and 10:30, two services. They're different times than this. If you show up at this time, you'll be a little early for the 10:30, and it'll be just great. We also have an Easter breakfast, kind of full breakfast, lots of fun, great food, good fellowship from 9 to 10 in our fellowship hall. That's what's coming up. And then you want me to say Easter egg hunt?
Sure.
Easter extravaganza on Saturday at 10:30. Easter egg hunt, there's a lunch, all that good stuff. Lots of full weekend if you want to come and join us for any of that, for all of that. That would be wonderful. My other announcements that are new have to do with April. An explorations class will be starting. If you are interested in learning about Christianity, learning about what Trinity believes as a congregation, what that means, and or becoming a member, this is the place to go. So we are starting class in April. If you're interested in that, let me know, please, and then I'll coordinate the schedule for who all's interested. We'll figure out how that'll work well. So let me know if you're interested. My email and phone numbers on the bulletin, or talk to the church office, let them know. That would be wonderful. We'll get that all coordinated. Second, our next adult Bible class starts on April 7th, and it is entitled Tough Questions of Faith. So we'll be talking about tough questions, tough topics, different things from April, or in April and May. So one, it's an invitation for you to come and be a part of that study, but two, if you have a particular question or a particular topic you want us to discuss and talk about, I would love to know that. So again, let me know or let the church office know. And I've got a couple of those already that'll help me kind of structure the class and guide us through. So this is really somewhat open forum, somewhat stump the pastor, somewhat ask me anything. But we're going to title it Tough Questions of Faith. So yeah, that's all I've got.
All right. So also this week, because there's not enough going on during Holy Week, on Tuesday night we have the Lutheran High School Concordia Academy. Their touring choir is coming and giving us a concert, so you're all invited to come for that concert at 7 p.m. on Tuesday night. And just a reminder, youth, there's lots of announcements about fun events coming up, so just make sure to look at those announcements. Thank you.
All right, with that, I'll invite you to stand, greet those worshipers around you, and I'll greet you in the back.